So thanks for attending this session, so which will be dedicated to present you some NoCode Showcases. So I'm very pleased to share this session with Caroline and Baptiste. So just to introduce myself, I'm co-founder and head of sales at Cube. So Cube is a French NoCode startup product research. We work with startups and also corporates. And we launch products, so essentially web apps. And we use essentially NoCode to build our products. So maybe before starting on the demos, Caroline, Baptiste, you can introduce yourself. Maybe we can start with you, Caroline, and move forward with your demo.
Hello, thank you. So I'm Caroline Egal, I'm co-founder of EY Fabernovel, the other co-founder, and we are a retail tech agency. And I will be very happy to show what we have built thanks to a low code solutions. We will say it's a SaaS platform dedicated to retail and sales management. So it's a B2B platform that we manage with low code solutions in partnership.
Thank you. And hello everybody. So my name is Baptiste. Yeah, I'm part of Unlock, so I co-founded Unlock and I'm running Unlock into the NoCode Studio into EY Fabernovel. And I will present all this ecosystem very soon because I will start this showcase. So,
you prefer to get into the
Let me try to do it. So, let's start with a quick presentation of our ecosystem and how we did NoCode in Fabernovel and Unlock. So Unlock, as I told you, is a NoCode studio into EY Fabernovel ecosystem. We love to say to our client that Fabernovel, with Fabernovel, we help our customer, our client, to make or to create new opportunities. So Faber make and novel new opportunities. And we launched Unlock, the NoCode studio, 1 year ago, so happy birthday to us. And, We launched this studio because we believe, one, that NoCode offers the opportunity to employees to develop their own ideas, which in the past wasn't possible because of a lack of budget, of time, of skills, you already know it. And secondly, our clients, or most of them, were aware of NoCode, or most, and they wanted to know more about it. So we launched to understand better this ecosystem, you can see Unlock, which is here, Fabernovel part, Unlock part of Fabernovel part of EY, and you will get it why. So Unlock is between 5 to 10 employees with more than 250 clients. And in Unlock, as I told you, we are part of Fabernovel, and Fabernovel is 350 employees. So it's again, just a consulting company which has been created in 2003. With more than 250 clients. That's why Unlock has 250 clients, because we are part of Fabernovel, in fact. Lucky with that, many of our clients are big or large companies. Since July, we are now part of EY. So now we are EY Fabernovel. And EY, as you already know, is more than 300,000 employees with a lot of different clients. So you understand the ecosystem is huge, and that's why we are again working with many big companies. Very quick, Unlock, we have three different pillars to our course. The first one is empowerment pillar, which consists of upskilling collaborators, those from the example of this case that we have done. The second one is innovation. We develop bugs and EP, internal application, chatbot information, and so on. And the last one is communication, communication tool. And we develop long pages, websites, e-commerce website. So let me deep dive for what you are in for, the presentation and the showcase. I will present one showcase that we have done, one project that we have done with L'Oréal and L'Oréal Beauty Tech. A bit bit about context of the project. So we've been working with let's say that L'Oréal team contacted us with one goal in mind. They wanted to help collaborators or to allow to offer to collaborators the opportunity to create their first application. So quite modern. Very nice. So as I told you, the goal in mind was to create or help collaborators to create their first application. One figure to keep in mind, the L'Oréal Beauty Tech is almost 2,000 employees, so it's 1,800 employees, so it's quite large. And the stack tool that we have to work with was mainly for platforms, so for ads, for automate, and for BI, and also AppSheet, because they wanted to try AppSheet in the same time. Last figure, the project took 4 to 5 months and finished in March this year. So how we did with that, or how we did the roadmap, the first phase was the following one. So the L'Oréal team created a lot of different content, so we had to review it and to challenge the content in the training part. The second phase was developing one, because we developed all the content that has been missing in the first phase, and at the same time we developed many applications, and I will talk about it later in order to have skilled collaborators. And the last one was the deployment, not the easiest one, but a very nice one, because we deployed all the projects with the 2,000 collaborators, almost 2,000 collaborators. So let me focus on the different phases. First one, as I told you, it was the framing one. So the framing one, as I told you, L'Oréal, they already create many content. So we help them to identify and classify all the different content by level of difficulty. And in the same time, we challenge, as I told you, many content. Because in this, let's say, phase, we saw that the content wasn't enough in order to upskill collaborators, and wasn't easy to understand what you have to do in order to upskill yourself and try to create your first application. So in this part,
is it knowledge management?
Part of.
Okay.
Yeah, part of. And I will talk about it later, because we develop a serpent as well, so we have to classify the beginning and three main focuses on this phase. The first one, obviously, was training, as I told you. Second one, designing, and hopefully we have a great design team, so you can see some great design on the slide as well. I'm going back for the slide and design.
We did not use the
topic. I got some help with that. And the last one was content. Here you can see some results. We try, you know, to create, let's say, an engagement, you know, in the community. So they had to always follow the same banner, the same design. And all the design, we share it, you know, with the communication in order to make some decisions. Second phase, development one. So I told you they create many content, but it was missing some content. So one part of the development one was to create some content, obviously. So when I said that, it was guideline, it was a starter kit, how to deal with Power Apps. How you can manage with the Power BI and so on. And this was one part, content one. And the other part was application. So we developed some application, three applications in fact. Two of the three applications, let's try to focus on the part, but two of the three applications were in order to acculturate collaborators. But there are no any goal than acculturate collaborators, and they could redevelop the application the lighting, because we develop or we create in the same time get like the last one. I will talk about it later, but the last one was a challenge app idea. So this process, I'm sorry for that, I will try to so all those let's say screenshots that you can see is either some application that we develop or some content that we develop as well. So here for example is I will talk about it now. It's the challenge idea apps of us. I told you two other two or three applications that were Android, and the other one was the challenge idea. The challenge idea app has been developed on four apps. And the idea of this challenge idea app was to help collaborators to submit their own ideas in order to develop them. Once they submit their own ideas, they had the possibility, you know, to vote and share for their favorite ideas. So here is the screenshot when they submit their project. Here is an example of the SharePoint. I talked about it very fast because we had to deal with the ecosystem. We haven't used any other tool, but we had to use SharePoint in order to classify and centralize all the different data. Here, the last screenshot in this part, it's another example, budget or app. I told you two of the three applications were for budget. This one was for budget. It's just an application budget or app in order to follow your budget internal investment. And if you liked it, you wanted to use it, you could redevelop it with guidelines step by step. And more apps again. Last phase, deployment. So we deployed all the program to the 1,800 employees. And as you can see here, is just the back office of the Power App application, the challenge idea app, where all the ideas were stored. On these parts, you can see some other screenshots. So here is the challenge idea app, you can connect. So here is the SharePoint one with many different contents, so startup teams and so on. This is almost the end. The key metrics and achievements of the project. So for the key metric, obviously the audience, because we talk or we try to acculturate less than 2,000 employees. So it's quite a nice figure for that. Other figure that other key metrics can say that we developed three different applications. In fact, we try to develop more than that, but we stopped three applications for acculturation. 26 application ideas was part of the call for ideas, sorry. More than 600 votes on common ideas, so there was a kind of emulation, and not everybody obviously was talking about it, but a lot of different people were talking about it and discover what is NoCode and what you can do with NoCode. And the last one, now, three applications are in the process of going to scale. So, in summary, I will just say that we can build or we can implement NoCode in a big company. We heard a lot of different stories, you know, in either startup, PMO, or a small company, but we can deal as well with a big company. There are still a lot of work to do, hopefully, for us, for everybody. But yeah, there is a big potential with NoCode in big company, and that's all. And thank you for your attention.
Now we will move forward to startup use case with Maia-Be. We will try to keep some time at the end.
So, what I will share today is my first experience with NoCode. And before sharing with you some details about the platform we managed to develop with NoCode tool, I will give you a little bit of context about Maia-Be, what we do at Maia-Be, what it has been created, and what issues we are solving for brands. Okay? You probably observe it that brands, and especially more premium and luxury ones, want to create more and more emotional experiences for their customers. And this is a really good news because you all know that customer experience has a huge impact on the business performance. Okay? The only thing is that until now, they still use quite traditional indicators, traditional measurement system, such as the NPS, the Net Promoter Score. I'm sure you're familiar with it. It's your propension, your propension to recommend a brand. So it's a simple question. It's quite good at evaluating, at measuring transactional experiences, but it's not good enough to measure and to understand emotional experiences, and also it's not really operational. And it is something that you can hear from many CX and retail managers, that gives the temperature, it gives you the temperature, but it does not say to you what you have to act on, what you have to do based on this indicator. Okay, so that's the overall context. And so the brands, the premium and luxury brands, have a clear objective. They want to create emotional experiences for their customer, but they have their, some limitations regarding the tools they have today. Okay, and it is especially challenging for them because you all know also that the context is the global environment is more and more complex because customer journeys are now totally omnichannel, totally hybrid between offline and online. You already know also that the Gen Z, the new generation, is very demanding regarding brands in terms of authenticity, transparency, but also in terms of experience. And the last thing is that there is a huge turnover among sales advisors in stores. So so it's clear that brands cannot rely only on human resources, but they need some tools. Okay. So that's the overall context and the challenge, and that's exactly why we created with Alto Maia-Be more than one year ago. And so, what is our ambition at Maia-Be? Our ambition is to make every moment in the store or online memorable and for customers. So every customer leave moments that matter for him. Okay? So it's really our ambition. And our mission, completely what we do, is that we deliver empowering tools to managers so they can completely act on this customer experience to accomplish this ambition of creating a moment that matters for their customers. Okay? So that's the overall context, and we decided for this to deliver operating tools, we decided to build a SaaS platform. Okay, a B2B SaaS platform that collects customer feedbacks, analyzes this emotional data coming from customers, and deliver concrete action plans. So really, end-to-end solution. And building such a product was a little bit challenging for us because we are not coming from the tech field. We are both coming from the market research field. So it was quite complicated. And to be honest, at the beginning, we were not so confident and not very at ease, especially because the first tech expert, not effective, we spoke with, explained to us that we are supposed to develop a full platform in code, and that it will take time, and we will have to spend a lot of money. Okay, so it was not really good news for us, especially because even the first part, writing the specification was quite impossible for us to do, as we were not talking the same language at all than this expert. But hopefully we were at the Willa incubator. Willa is the incubator for female in tech. And we are very lucky, and we are very lucky and grateful for these experts because they help us on two things. First thing, they help us in reshaping our needs. And clearly, our needs were not to develop a full platform with all the functionalities and totally finalized, but it was to get the MVP quite quickly so we can test it ASAP with one of our clients. So first thing, and the second thing is that they introduced us to Q. And from the starting point, things went much better. so we are grateful and lucky with Willa, but we also have been lucky in terms of timing, because I think that the same week we were starting our collaboration with Thomas' team, we signed a first client project. Is a very famous fashion sportswear brand. be a good week. And we started to work on the first first MVP. Okay. And so yes. So first MVP and what was good by with the collaboration with Cube is that we had a phase before development, which is a conception. So we were very reassured by this process. Can appear a little bit rigid at the beginning, but at the end, the conception phase was very valuable for us because it enabled us to have something really in line with what was relevant for our business and for our clients. And the team was really good at understanding our needs and our clients' needs, of course, but also to translate them into a relevant visualization. So we started by the consumer interface because, as you understood, I hope, the entry point of our solution is the collect of the consumer feedback. So that's why we started by this consumer interface. And so you can see that it's, first it's customizable according to the brand identity. Second, it's really user friendly and visually engaging. And also because we know that customers are not ready to answer a lot of questions, we decided to have a very short questionnaire. It's only 4 questions, mixing open-ended question and a good ones. So that's why for the first part of our platform, so the consumer interface, and then we move to the full platform, so end-to-end platform, including not only the consumer interface, but also the brand interface, and of course, it's the most valuable part of our solution because our clients are brands. Hopefully, our clients are CX and retail managers, can be also marketing or CMI teams. Okay. So, what I will show you some characteristics and functionalities of this brand interface. So, the first characteristic is that it's omnichannel, so it fits. It addresses the challenge of omnicanality. You can so gather on the same platform data from what happened in your stores and what happened on your shop. The second thing is that you have a customized view according to type of users. So typically, if you are at the headquarters, or if you are in a store, or if you are in a you belong to the e-com team, you do not have the same view, use the same access to the dashboard. Other particularities of our brand interface is that our dashboard is visually consistent with emotional data. It was really important for us that we have something that visually fits with the philosophy we want for us and for the brands we work for. So that's why you have a store, but you also have a nice air balloon coming up and coming down according to your performances. Okay? And you see some score, you see some spider charts, so some data. But what is important also for you to note is that behind all is structured according to our algorithm. So it means that it's not only flat sorting, but you have an algorithm behind this. So it shows once again how no-code solutions have a strong power to deliver quite a complex platform. And of course, because you need insights to act beyond data. Data is not enough. In our dashboard, in our brand interface, you have insights to understand your performance. Where does it come from? about the type of profile the customer, the type of profile of customer you have, and you have also all the verbatim connected to the question. Okay, and as NoCode is clearly about agility, we are already working on the next step, and the next step will be the integration of action plan. Today we deliver action plan, but more on the consultancy way, because it's not already embedded in our platform. But it is the next step, and we are quite confident that it will work. So, and I hope the Cube team is confident too regarding this. But I'm sure. So as you understand, we are very happy with this with everything that happened on this NoCode project, because we had MVP in 3 weeks and a full platform in 8 weeks. Our solution, so less than 10 months after the first talk we did with this fashion sportswear brand, we have our solution deployed in 3 countries, and it will be in 2 more countries by the end of this year. We have a database today with more than 1500 customers feedbacks, and by the end of the of this year, we will also have more than 250 B2B users, both headquarters people and people from the boutiques, of course, and people from the e-commerce, so really different profiles of users. And I think that's it.
Thank you. And I would like to congratulate your business execution, especially after the MVP, because it was also challenging for the Cube team to follow the rhythm of technical implementation.
But you help us to reshape our roadmap, to prioritize our needs. So it's also a win-win partnership. Because
I think we learned a lot about our business, but we learned also a lot about product management roadmaps.
Thank you.
So let's move to the last showcase for this session, the EY platform. This is one of our clients' project at Cube. We recently released our clients couldn't be here at the event. But I would like to share with for him this use case, because it's quite interesting, because it's quite challenging and it's mobilized low code approach for this project. So maybe you are familiar with NFTs or crypto, but basically crypto is a booming industry, and of course inside the business there are recently NFTs, and NFTs are some unique collection of items and which bear a certificate of authenticity that makes them unique. And in this business, many companies, especially large companies, are looking for solutions to exploit the benefits from the NFT opportunity to send, for instance, some NFTs to their client base, to thank them for their loyalty, for instance. But NFTs are quite complex. Today it's quite complex to create, to deliver, and that's how the Airgift startup and project was born, to facilitate the creation and sending of NFTs to four companies. It can be considered as the machine for sending group of NFTs if you use the cross platform. So we helped the startup to launch first one on the project, and it's innovative. And it was a challenging project, as I said, because it's quite technical, and I will show you today the fun fact, indeed, the organizers of NoCode Summit sent to the super early bird ticket holder some NFTs. I don't know if you were on the list. if you were a ticket holder but you did not receive the NFT, you can directly
right.
I don't know if you have a team to handle So, how the organizers created and sent NFTs directly with the Maia-Be platform, and show us the process basically to create and to send NFTs for Maia-Be. So, first thing to do, it's quite the same if you are accustomed with sending blue, it's quite the same process. The first thing to do is to create the marketing campaign. So, in the SaaS, after we create an account, you have the possibility to do your app. There is an onboarding to create a new collection that will be sent to users, in which one there are many things to do. You can parameter at first the description of course for your campaign and add some visuals, some logos to your company or the company in question. And the second step, of course, is to import the visuals of the NFT that will be sent to the users. So there, you can import basically a list of visuals, or the last feature of the product is to directly build your visual inside the very simple. When you import your visuals, you can assign a max supply for each visual, because to give a number of times that user can mine the NFT after the same. When the collection is set up, the next step is to add or import beneficiaries. Three ways to do this. First one manually, you can add address email, first and surname, or you can import a list via CSV of users to be the beneficiaries. We also, there are some modes to create some APIs to also connect with our systems to import users. When the campaign is set up, next step is to customize the emails that will receive different beneficiaries. And we created a fully custom email configurator, both for the first email, which is sent the first time we release the campaign, and also you can configure a reminder. You can configure, I don't know, maybe 5 days after the release, if the users do not open the email, you can. And then you can configure the email contents, adding a subject and contents, and you can also blur the assets, the image, to create more surprise. It's a great feature, and it was a nice job, but I think it's great for marketing to have purpose. But that was not for this example, because there were two types of assets for the NCS, the gold one and the regular, but here we can already know that we are not the winner of the politics. So, when we customize, after customizing the emails, next step is to launch the campaign. So, validate, of course, everything is okay, and go back and launch, of course, before you have to pay some credits. But business model is only to you buy some credits, and one credit is important to one NFT. So, it's perfect. And when it's released, the beneficiaries will receive the emails, and they can after mint the NFT. For the company, we created a functional dashboard with some metrics and indicators to follow its campaign. So again, it's similar to what you can find on MailChimp or Google. So the number of beneficiaries of the campaign, number of emails sent, number of open emails also, we track this file. And the last one, which is quite important, is the number of NFT retrieved. So NFT that has been minted by the user and added to their wallet. So this is for the, I would say, the company. And for users, they receive an email with a call to action, and they get there is a call to action to redirection to a page, in which one they can access to their NFT, which is unique, and to they can mint it and so add to their wallet. Connect directly to MetaMask or Wallet Connect, and retrieve their unique NFT. So, in the context of the NoCode Summit, 5 lucky tickets of those have received the whole NFT and get 3 tickets for the next station. Is there a winner here? Sorry. and you are congratulating for this. So it can be used for.
Can you sell it?
Sell it?
Yeah.
After you can bet, of course, there is a notion of value behind it. I don't know, maybe the first edition or the first NFT edition will be in the future or an important thing. We will see. So, as a conclusion, for this project, which is quite large and quite technical, because we implemented basically, as you may understand, some external APIs to. So, basically, the platform was built with Google on the developer approach, but we integrated some external APIs. First, one postmark for emailing because we create a custom mail emailing service to send multiple emails at once. And for the NFT team meeting, we use also a solution because, of course, with the NoCode, we will always try to find if there is a solution to integrate and not to create a code on top of the web if it's not necessary. And in the case of NFT meetings, this is quite different. There are some companies that do it. So we built it. We designed the platform and the product design in 4 weeks, and after we developed the project in 5 weeks, which is quite challenging again for this type of project. Apart from the NoCode Summit event, the platform I cannot disclose today, but it's currently experimented by some great players, especially marketing services, to experiment. That's it. We have remaining time, so if you have questions on different skills. Yes?
Yeah. At the beginning of such a project, for example, how do you, or like, how much time do you take to assess feasibility, or what do you do to assess feasibility? So, like, to see whether this can actually build with your approaches, or whether you could potentially run into roadblocks at some point.
Yeah. So for this type of project, we have first phase, which is discovery and things. And then we do both product design, scoping and design, and yeah, design and the UI. This phase will allow us to really understand the scope and the final development scope that we will integrate part of. So this first step is essential, of course, to the idea of the development needs.
And how long does that typically take you? Like,
4 weeks.
I understand. Okay.
On the 4 weeks, you have the test of the NFT or
yeah, sure. We do a technical investigation to make sure that Benny is the right solutions for this. But also there is a cost for our clients, the business plan.
So it's a question for Maia-Be. From the idea that you have, and from my understanding, Cube developed the tool.
Yes.
Is now the idea that you own the tool and you're going to tweak it and use it? Are you still having this relationship where if you need expansion and developments?
Yes. At this stage, we still need expansions and we still need a partnership with Cube. In the management of the product, we are autonomous. I manage the campaigns for the clients. I export the data from the database or from the dashboard. But each time we do some evolution, for the moment, we are still with the Cube because we are not tech people. They do it very well, and we prefer to be concentrated on the art of our business. Maybe one day we'll be happy to have someone internally to manage this type of features. But for the moment, it's still an external partnership. We do not do any evolution by ourselves.
But I think it's a great question. Also, still how to train the team after some of our clients manage their project by themselves or with some of the local development team. Not always the case, I would say half-half.
But your organization enables this option because you have a project manager and
We can stay
We will test a bubble for our model integration of model statistics. The only thing is that the big risk with bubble, to be honest, is that they triple their prices. We are in a B2B business, so to be honest, for today, as it is today, bubble is really cheap for us compared to our business. But of course, I know that Webflow increased a lot their prices. Typically, Google do the same. So it raises the question of can we stay on Google or do we have to move on the other? But it's also the job of the agency. to recommend and to update us about NoCode solutions that are more valuable or if we need some.
From our perspective, it is the thing that most likely, especially in the scale of the world, we want to have our limits. For B2C, it can be challenging, but we have some of them also. B2C marketplaces with many visitors per month, and it stays stable on our level. But yeah, it can be another. This is a great question, but in general, we discuss it maybe 1 year and a half after the
Just a question on the expression that happens in governments that this kind of thing is global and previously the question is when you work with the company, then the question is about the government.
We do not collect personal data because all identification codes we collect are encrypted. So we cannot recognize the person which is behind its back. But we have this unique identification code. So at the end, we can the brand, so our client, can match it. Can match. But we do not own any personal data. And that's also something quite important regarding Bubble. When you use Bubble, it's better than personal data.
Yeah, we're getting an NFT here with the roadmap. We
I have a question regarding the email service postmark and the business model of the platform. You had to develop the protection when one brand or one client of Airgift would just use it for email spam. And in the sense of, do you have some form of atomization of the IP and the score of emailing for every client or of Airgift? And I would say, yeah, would share the same email score, and we cross fingers for that no one of the clients of Airgift is a spammer with email.
Today I
think it's a solution. Yeah, cross fingers. No, because it's always a subject that.
But I think they will not spam through Airgift because the business model is
one email per NFT and
you
the credit.
Pay, for example, you send 100
NFTs. It costs you a credit.
Yeah.
Maybe not for Airgift in particular, but in general, how do you tackle the fact that you are giving email powers to a brand that might just assume that it's free for all, and there is this IP or reputation to maintain if your server is being flagged as this spam, at some point all the other clients get also add pictures.
Yeah, maybe I'm not sure of that, so, but I think we for most of the So maybe they flag this will be the responsibility of the brand or the company.
Okay, so there is this.
Our servers or
no, no, of course not Bubble, not Cube, maybe not even Airgift, but my question is at the level of inside the SaaS. It's a very pointy question.
We have this issue in our project, and we send some emails to the client into the when we use the team, for example, even if we have a Polo account, and we could, and we have to send it, please, let's use only one server for us because other companies may spam or we don't know. We just answer to us that in our four accounts, we share with four different companies servers. They restrict the access and they make some checks in order to be online. After you know, have some people who may spam them. You know, show the money. But still, if you want to have the server by yourself, we mention the list.
It's always the same question. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, there is some perfect premium corporate service, but then you don't want to pay that, and then you want to share it. But if you share it with someone that is unresponsible.
Yeah. Thank you very much.